It's amazing what turns up in my office at times at home. And this piece of paper has been floating around my office for a long time. I don't know why this one endured when not much else did from the early days. But this is the newsletter of this church. It says on the top, Peace Memorial Baptist Church. And the date of the newsletter is the 28th of August, 1988. And it's got my old phone number there and all. And so every week we used to put one of these out. This was pre-digital days. And the heading on here is Revival Power. Now, this was my first year in the church. And we spent a lot of time that year teaching people how to believe God, teaching faith, teaching how to get prayers answered, teaching about a richer life in the Holy Spirit, and so on and so forth, teaching about healing, and we began to see a lot of healing. But of course, it was my first year in the church, and one of the things that had been said to me, in fact, it had been said by Graham Thompson's father, who was kind of like the head deacon in those days. He was church secretary when I was called to be the pastor. And one of the things he said to me was that the church was looking for someone to lead them into renewal. But renewal means different things to different people, and they might not have known what they were asking for. Because the church in those days sang a few modern choruses and had a few house groups and thought that was renewal. But the deacons had already banned prophecy because there was no pastor and it couldn't be kind of governed. And so I came along, but I had a fairly high view of what renewal is, shall we say. And so I began to teach life in the Spirit, especially faith and prayer and healing. But I knew that sooner or later we would have to teach the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And it's a scary thing to teach the baptism of the Holy Spirit with speaking in tongues and other gifts of the Spirit to Baptists, or for that matter, any evangelical church in those days. And it was a whole year before one Sunday, this was August 88, it was February 89 that I decided the day had come and I had to get some courage, and it did require courage, to have a Sunday in which you taught straight out the baptism of the Holy Spirit with spiritual gifts, that is specifically the speaking in tongues. Because I didn't know what would happen, I only knew that for the church to come into the fullness of the Spirit, it had to be taught. But this was the kind of thing we were putting into the church in preaching and literature. I'll tell you what happened on that Sunday in a minute, will I? It was a pretty interesting Sunday. But just to give an example, now last Sunday David spoke about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, right? Is that not right? And what we're wanting to do is for 4 or 5 Sundays, concentrate on it, different aspects of it, because you need to be hungry. Every one of you and every one of us, I've said to all the leaders, like I've said to David Hood, David Alley, Tony, Philip, Jonathan, Michael, I've said we need to be hungry for a new baptism of the Holy Spirit, a fresh one. We don't want just a renewal of what we've had all along. We must go to another level. We must be baptized in the Holy Spirit again. And we must start looking for it. And if we want the whole church to be hungry and looking for a fresh baptism of the Spirit, we must be super hungry ourselves. And so what we've done is we've set aside a day a week for prayer. So last Wednesday, we met for prayer, not just the fellas, wives, we're all welcome, at our house, and that we will meet at our house again this Wednesday, the next Wednesday, the next Wednesday, specifically to seek afresh the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But we want the whole church to become hungry for a new measure of the Spirit. Now, David gave you some examples last Sunday of the baptism of the Spirit that fell upon some of these, you know, famous names in Christian ministry from the past. And this here quotes some of those guys, what they had to say. I'm not going to read all this. There's no time, but Spurgeon is here, and Moody and Finney, and a fellow called William Arthur, There were great revivals back in the 1800s, long before Azusa Street and the Pentecostal movement, the modern Pentecostal movement. There were great revivals. These were big Holy Spirit revivals. And things like the China Inland Mission, the CSSM, the Salvation Army were all born out of that. And they all knew mighty baptisms of the Spirit. And anyway, I won't bother reading from that, but it was interesting. And what happened, I had been, if you like, educating the church in the way of faith and the Spirit. And then finally, this day came that I thought, man, I've got to teach about tongues. So this Sunday morning, all week long, I thought about it. You know, I was searching the scriptures because I wanted to do a message, 13 reasons why every Baptist should speak in tongues. But I couldn't find 13. I could only find 10 in the Bible for myself. So that Sunday morning, I decided, right, I'll have to preach 10 reasons why every Baptist should speak in tongues, but I didn't call it that. And but of course, in those days there was a lot of controversy over it. And so what I said was, I said, look, everybody needs to understand speaking in tongues, whether you like it or not, whether you're interested or not. And I said, I'll tell you why. There are so many millions and millions of Christians in the world today who are baptized in the Spirit and speak in tongues. I said, half the church in the world does, and the other half are not sure. I said, but you're going to be living with people one way or another who speak in tongues, even if you don't like it. So, here's the deal. If you speak in tongues, you need to know what it's for. And if you don't speak in tongues, you need to understand what is the significance of this thing that's happening in the church and is meaningful to other people. So I said, therefore, everybody today has an interest in understanding the gift, even if you don't choose to walk in it. And so I then taught what the Bible had to say about it, its high value, its usage. And if you like, I'll share some of that next Sunday. But I taught then this high value of that gift relative to the baptism of the Spirit. And it is high value. I mean, the Apostle Paul, come on, no less an authority than the Apostle Paul said, I speak in tongues more than you do. Now, but he went on to emphasize the value of prophecy, and the way tongues is meant to fit in with everything else, and you worship in with your mind, and you worship with your spirit, and you pray with your mind, you pray with your spirit. We'll look at all that later. But I taught that on that Sunday morning, and the Sunday morning was, from memory, the 28th of February, 1989. And here was the historical bit. That night, the same Sunday night, I came back, preached again on how to be filled with the Holy Spirit, with speaking in tongues. And I gave an appeal, and the whole church came forward, including all the deacons of the church, all the Baptist deacons. And we laid hands on them all, and, you know, vast numbers baptized in the Holy Spirit, and the church started moving at a whole new level. But this was the beginning of my second year. I noticed something in the church. I noticed that whereas the bulk of the church was getting excited, moving in the Holy Spirit, there was growth, there was new people, there was one section of the church not growing. And they were sitting along the back row. They were the older teenagers in the church, and they were good kids. They'd come from good families, but they were just not moved. They were just somehow stuck in a rut, not spiritually awakened. These were the 16, 17, 18-year-olds. And it didn't matter what you did, the adults were getting excited, the church as a whole was excited, and these kids were just sitting there in the back row, unmoved and just good kids. I asked somebody in the church, I said, what is this? And they said, well, this church has always been like that. I said, well, not anymore. And I decided I'd have to take this special group into my house. And so I put on a special Friday night meeting for senior high and university kids that was limited to the 16 to 20-year-olds. Now, in those days, we had about 10 of them in the church, but some were not available. Now, one of them was Michael Appleton. When I came to the church, Michael was 14. But by this time, he was 16. But he was already leading the junior high youth group. So he wasn't available Friday night. But we had 8 kids who were available. And amongst them was Blair Harp, who now, you know, he's a headmaster and known in the district, and Blair and I became pretty good friends, actually, and he came with me to Zimbabwe, and I like Blair. Well, Blair was just a senior high kid in those days, and there was a bunch of others, only eight. Now, we got these kids to come to my house on Friday night, and there were two things these kids couldn't really do. One is they were not interested in singing, and they weren't really very good at praying. And so even though you're going to have a Friday night meeting, it doesn't leave much, right? But I thought, no, we're not going to make them work hard. So we kept the singing really simple, just a couple of happy songs, guitar. And we kept the prayers really simple, just a few short prayers. But what I did on Friday nights was I told them a lot of stories. I told them stories about what I'd seen God do, the answers to prayer that I had seen, the power of the Holy Spirit poured out, the miracles I had seen. What was I doing? I was teaching faith. I was teaching these kids something about a God they never knew. I was teaching through stories, narrative theology, you call it. But what they didn't know was that Hazel and I, every single day of the week, were praying two prayers for those kids. Every day, Hazel and I were praying that they would get baptized in the Holy Spirit. Now, that's the buzzword for our theme at the moment, right? The baptism of the Holy Spirit. We're praying that. And the other one, I was praying they'd become worshippers. 8 months went past of me filling them with faith stories, and we had a youth camp. And somehow, miraculously, a month or so before the youth camp, someone told me about Dave Smethurst and said, look, he's available, would you like him? And I said, well, I need someone for youth camp. And so we invited Dave Smethurst, and he turned out to be absolutely masterful when it came to teaching the things of the Spirit. And so we had a whole youth camp, and because it wasn't just the senior high, those group, it was all the younger ones, it was older ones, it was more than was in that group. I suppose we had 45 or 50 in the camp, might have been 70 in the camp. And every single young person in the camp came home from the camp baptized in the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues. It was astounding. A huge, huge breakthrough late in our second year. And the result was that that group of eight that had been meeting with me for 8 months in our house grew, and by the new year, we had 20. And by the next new year, we had 43 meeting in our lounge room, kids getting saved every Friday night, healings taking place every Friday night. And that was the point at which we took the meeting to the church, and it grew to over 100. And so it was a major youth movement. And in those days, a lot of kids were getting saved out of university, out of senior high. Kids were coming in that had never been Christians before. And that went on for years and years. It was a great work. But it came from the fact, what? The church got the breakthrough in the baptism of the Spirit, and then our youth got the breakthrough in the baptism of the Spirit. And I'm suggesting that every single one of you needs to get afresh a breakthrough in the baptism of the Spirit, whether you've had one before or not. Now, some of you might never have known a real baptism of the Spirit like that. Others have. Either way, I'm suggesting a whole fresh hunger for God is needed. Now, hunger is what it's all about. Could I please make it very plain? The more hungry you are for God, the more He will give you. I've seen people who were sitting in church, you know, never had any particular hunger for God, but this gets taught about and appeal is given, and oh, they feel moved and they come forward, get a little prayer, and sure, they'll get some release in gifts of the Spirit, they'll start speaking in tongues, but they never got a huge load of power, just a small dose. Why? Because they were not all that hungry for God. But I've seen other people so hungry for God that the Lord won't answer them immediately, and He'll let them pray on and pray on and pray through. And finally, when the Holy Spirit falls on them, just clobbered with power because they were so hungry. And that's what happened to me. Now, hunger is everything. Remember Jesus said, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they will be filled." The hungrier you are, the more you will get, and so on and so forth. So, remember this verse too, Old Testament one. It says, "You will seek me and you will find me when you search for me with all your heart." Now, if you just leave the last bit off for a minute, "You will seek me and you will find me when you search for me." See, God, if you search for God, He makes Himself known. But what He says is, "You'll seek me and you'll find me when you search for me with all your heart." He's really wanting that big-hearted search that nothing else will do. You want more of God. You want to break through. Let me tell you, power is available to you. Now, what I want to do with my chosen victims for the day, now these are my friends, is I want to ask them, and another Sunday we'll have Jonathan and we'll find a few others, I want to ask David what happened when he was baptized in the Holy Spirit. Now we can't take all day about this. We've only got a few minutes. So you've got to be fairly succinct. But, you know, what was going on in your heart? What did you want? What did you pray? What did God do? What came about afterwards? That's a big one. All right? So, David, start answering questions. Yeah. Tell us about your baptism of the Spirit.
I had several baptisms of the Spirit. And the first one was when I, as just an 11-year-old, just simply believed that it was the gift of tongues. That's all I thought. And when I prayed and I got the gift of tongues, pretty much straight away, after a few days of praying, and I was happy. But as an adult looking back on it, and I always thought that was my baptism of the Holy Spirit. But I realised in more recent times that I actually had several baptisms of the Holy Spirit, but some of them I didn't realise that's what I was praying for. There'd be a thing I was seeking God for so much, and then I'd receive a touch of God, and really what I was receiving was another whole baptism of the Holy Spirit, but I just hadn't used that language. And the most recent one was about 5 years ago, where I'd spent a whole year praying for the body of Christ in Rockhampton and Mount Morgan. And on this one day, I received such a touch of God where I instantly loved all God's people. There was one brother that's such a strange individual, but I just loved him and accepted him, even with his weird doctrines. And the Lord did such a work in my heart in one moment that I've never seen the body of Christ the same way that I did before again. And I have a real sense of belonging with all of God's people, and a real sense of oneness. And that was something that God did, but I didn't realize at the time I was being baptized in the Holy Spirit. I just was praying for the church, and then I received a real touch of God as a result. And that's the most recent of these experiences that I've had. But now that we've been talking about this, of course, I'm getting hungry for another one.
The early Salvation Army, this is back in the 1860s, and the like, William Booth, the founder, had a very high view. He believed that the really significant qualification for Christian life, for holy living, as well as for power in winning souls, which he was greatly interested in, was in the baptism of the Spirit, which it is. And so he urged it on his followers, and it was common practice in the Salvation Army for Friday nights, all Friday night, to be spent in prayer, waiting on God, crying out to God. And the stories of those early years are incredible, how the power of God would fall on those all-night prayer meetings so that people would often be rebaptized in the Holy Spirit every Friday night. And then they'd go out and on Saturdays and Sundays preach, and huge numbers of people would come to Christ, which made the Salvation Army such a powerful movement all those early decades, and went all over the world, bringing huge numbers to the Lord. The history is quite astounding. Your first baptism of the Spirit, David, how old were you?
It's 11.
11. So tell us about that one.
I guess we'd been in the church. I joined this church with Dad and Mum when I was 10, so it would be the next year, and I guess that's what you were talking about. I can't remember the details, but I just remembered, you know, praying in my bedroom and asking God to give me the Holy Spirit. And in my mind, I was thinking, I want to be able to speak in tongues. And after a few days of personal prayer in my bedroom, I was able to just speak in tongues. Even though it was a kind of weird thing, but I was happy. I got what I was asking for.
Now, people might have questions about speaking in tongues, but we'll address that next Sunday. We'll tell you what it is, how it works, how to make use of that gift, and so on. But for a majority of people who break through in the Holy Spirit, it's the first thing that happens. It's not yet so universal that that's what is the first thing that happens with everybody. It's not the guarantee that someone's baptized in the Spirit. Even in the Bible, there are some examples of people who prophesied rather than speaking in tongues, but it was very common. And even today, when you're released in that gift, it seems like a whole lot of other gifts are activated. It's like it's something that seems to kick everything else into gear. It's not to be despised at all. It's to be understood and worked with, but it certainly is a delightful release. What else happened along the way that was significant in the power outcomes?
In Mount Morgan, I had probably 5 or 6 years when I was first up there as a pastor. Went up there when I was 19, and I had the real, you know, heart to see God save people and all of that. And I had probably, I think it was 6 years of fruitless effort, but fruitless I made a big effort for 6 years, and I did lots of things up there that just didn't work. And was one of the reasons why so many other people got frustrated and gave up. But I remember Barry Cunnington from the Ten of Promise saying to me one day, he said, it's God that builds the church. He said, you can't build the church. And I had a breakthrough in the year that followed that as I poured my time and effort into prayer for God to build the church. And the Lord did a whole heap of things in me personally, and also just things in the town where I began to see God just move almost as if it had nothing to do with me. But it actually had come from my prayers. And I involved, of course, the few people in the church in prayer with me. But one of those things was we had a whole month of prayer for revival, and we prayed every morning and every night. We prayed an hour at morning at 6 and an hour at night at 6 for a whole month. And so that was one of the key things that changed me and gave me a real sense of faith that God was able to save people, which I'd never had before. And another one was what I shared last Sunday, how I'd spent a whole 3 days in prayer confessing my sins. What Charles Finney describes as, in his chapter 3 on Lectures of Revival, how to have a revival, the confession of your sins in detail. So I'd spent 3 days in prayer doing that and filled up 40 pages of sins in my book. And after that, I had a real sense of being full of the Holy Spirit. In fact, I'd spent several hours on a Saturday afternoon in pain on the floor, what the Bible calls travail. My stomach was all in knots and I was crying and in tears, but the Holy Spirit was flowing through me. And these were all some of the experiences I had with God. And in the years 2003 and 2004, it seemed that we had no problems having people join the church, which is completely contrasting difference to all those 6 years before. And the only differences were these experiences we had in prayer and the seeking that we did after God, and also faith in Him to build the church, not in our own efforts. In fact, I didn't do any evangelism in those 2 years. We only prayed, that's all we did.
No, great. Thank you, David. And in fact, success in soul winning is one of the biggest things that comes out of the baptism of the Spirit. I broke through in the baptism of the Spirit in the year 1974. I had been converted in 1967 and really walked with the Lord. In fact, within months of being converted, I put a fair bit of time into the prayer to be full of the Holy Spirit, and I used to spend a lot of time witnessing. So I suppose I witnessed to hundreds and hundreds of people in the 4, 5, 6 years until 1974, but never saw a lot of results for the effort. And yet I always felt deeply in my conscience, I must share Christ. You couldn't go past a hitchhiker and not pick them up. These days you don't pick up hitchhikers. Back then, I was picking them up all the time, sharing Christ with them. But in 1974, I got really, really hungry for God. Now, I was already full of the Holy Spirit in the traditional way, and serving Christ and sold out to the Lord and full of biblical understanding. But I got really, really hungry for God. And I discovered there was a baptism of the Spirit of another level altogether. I'd been reading books. In those days, the significant books, they were huge, multi-million bestsellers all over the world. Prison to Praise, 9 o'clock in the morning. These are the things that turned whole movements worldwide. I read those books, got so hungry for God. So by early 1974, I started praying with 3 other people. And we stayed in prayer 5 days. Now, we had to go to lectures, so we weren't sitting in the same spot 5 days. But we'd pray late in the evening. First night, I think we prayed to 2 a.m., 2:30 a.m. But we'd be in and out of lectures the next day. But I never stepped out of the Spirit. All day long, I remained in the Holy Spirit, holding on to God, looking for this baptism of the Spirit, and then broke through on the fifth night. I'll tell more about what happened, but I want to tell you about this one outcome. In college, we were in Bible college at the time, there were 31 people who were in our session. That is 31 people who began the same course, same time as us. It was a live-in course. There were some married, some singles. And we used to do regular outreaches from college. So Tuesday afternoons, we'd be out doing outreach in parks, we'd run park Sunday schools and gather kids up, sing songs and share the gospel. Sundays we're out doing the same thing in churches, open air meetings. Pretty active, it was very practical training. And the Salvation Army keeps pretty tight records, who went where and all the decisions that are made get recorded, And so they actually had numbers. This 31 people out doing all this evangelism in parks and streets and whatnot, every decision, a decision here and 3 there, 5 souls saved there, it's all recorded. Well, here was the amazing thing. Within that first month or two, I was the first one with another fellow that broke through in the baptism of the Spirit, but ultimately there were 9 of us, 9 of the 31 that got baptized in the Holy Spirit. After 5 or 6 months of all this evangelizing in open air meetings and parks, an analysis showed that almost every soul that had been brought to Christ, almost every decision that had been made anywhere on that list, they had been brought to Christ by one of the 9 people that had been baptized in the Holy Spirit. Almost all the decisions. See, so there is power. When the Holy Spirit comes upon you, it's like Jesus said, you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses. It's a wonderful spin-off. Anyway, here is Tony and Carolyn. Long years of experience in seeking the Lord, right? Yes, all those days of prayer, nights of prayer. Anyway, here's a microphone. So we're going to quiz them a little bit because they were still in the Salvation Army, as were David and Judy, back in the days when they got hungry for the baptism of the Spirit. But you were here in Rocky, weren't you? Or you're still in Bundy? Okay. Well, Tony, tell us when that was.
Yes, funny you should ask. I don't remember the date, but at the time we were in the Salvation Army, yes, it was before 1988, we were in the Salvation Army in Bundaberg, and we had a guy come to our church. We were the youth leaders, and this guy started to talk to our youth about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and we didn't like that. And then the COC came to town, the Christian Outreach Centre, and a hunk of the youth group that we were leading went with him to the COC, and we were very upset about that. And after a time, I was still mates with these guys that left. We were still mates with them, and we played indoor cricket with them. And then David and Judy came up and started talking as well about the Salvation Army minister that they had come to their church and was talking to them about things of the Spirit, and there might actually be something in this. Because we were taught, no, this is not good. This is not right. And this is overexcitement and so on and so forth. And it was not for us. So we got more and more interested and more hungry. And then one night in Bundaberg, I had been given or got a book called How to Be Baptized in the Spirit by Don Basham. And I lay down and read this book one night. It was a booklet. And I got to the end and it said, now just ask for the Holy Spirit and then open your mouth and speak in tongues. So I did. And I spoke in tongues for about 2 minutes. And I said to myself, that can't be right. And I just closed it all down. Not long after, we got even more hungry and we decided we'd come to Rockhampton, to where this minister was ministering to David and Judy in the church up here. And we got started being taught on the whole. Yes, we were that hungry, we left a town to go to another town to receive the Holy Spirit. That's how hungry we were. Carolyn's parents thought we were crazy, but that's another story. We came into the town and we were being taught. And then this one weekend, Frank Houston was speaking at the Assemblies of God, the COP. And the minister at the Salvation Army said, come on, grab the bunch of us young people. Said, come up and let's listen to what he's got to say. And he was speaking that night on some subject. However, you may or may not know, but Frank Houston is an ex-Salvation Army officer. And that's Brian Houston's father. And all of a sudden, he changed tack and started speaking about his testimony on the Salvation Army when he was off. Even halfway through the message, he was saying, I don't know why I'm talking about this stuff. But he didn't know there was a bunch of salvos sitting up the back of the church all listening to this stuff. And I had said to Carolyn before we went, Carolyn, I don't care what happens. We're just going to sit in our seats and listen to this tonight. We're not moving. Okay.
I'll tell the rest of the story because that's where I got left in the seats whilst he rushed to the front. And I was none too impressed about that. And I was going to stand my ground in the seats for a good while, but Sharon Studley encouraged me to go forward. And for me, yes, it was probably more a real, I guess, disillusionment and tiredness that sent me running to God, because, you know, I'd grown up in the Salvation Army and made a decision to follow Jesus when I was 8, went right through the whole procedure of it all in the salvos, and Tony and I ran the whole youth section of our church in Bundaberg from which covered from birth till about 30, and we were just had it, really. And I got to thinking, there has to be more than this, you know, there just has to be more than this. And of course, our friends having left and everything, that was a huge catalyst. But for me, it was like, there has to be something more than what I've got. And we knew we were called to the ministry, and it was really only looking like a couple of years down the track till we'd be going. And I thought, we have to have something happen in us so we can live through this. You know, I thought, I can't imagine going through the ministry without some extra kind of power. So anyway, the story was, we went down the front that night, and we were standing nowhere near each other due to the quick movement of Tony being right down the front and me being at the back way over there, and he was like over here. And it was then that Frank Houston said, "You two, are you together?" And I'm thinking, what? Why would you think that? Tony figures he must have seen us together. But I'm not convinced. And he prayed for us to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Tony was speaking in tongues before he hit the floor. And me, I just stood there. Yep, nothing. And nothing in my mind anyway. And they really encouraged you to open your mouth and speak. And I'm thinking, how do you do that? Being the very, how would you describe me? Oh, thank you. Tony offered religious for the word there, but it was more my way of thinking, you know, very analytical and that sort of thing. But so they're saying, you know, just open your mouth and speak. I'm thinking, how can you just open your mouth and speak? You don't know what you're going to speak, and, you know, nothing. And it turned out when we went home, and of course I was getting really annoyed because all Tony was doing was speaking in tongues. You know, everywhere you went, off he was. Off he went. And, you know, got down beside the bed. Oh, God. You know, I really want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. I really want to be released in this. Anyway, long story short, ended up needing to have a spirit of religion broken over me before I was able to be released. And once that was done, and I think, you know, this is God's sense of humor sometimes, I had one word. One word. I'm thinking, what am I supposed to do with one word? And then it was suggested, well, you just speak it over and over again. I thought, just to make me feel like a complete idiot, I'll say the one word over and over again. Anyway, as time went on, I got released into a complete language. But my life completely changed at that time. Hunger for God, hunger for the word, just couldn't get enough of it, you know? And the power, like, it was just transformation for me.
Oh, okay.
Just after that, we used to, David and Judy and I, we used to get into groups and pray, and people were getting decked and all sorts of stuff. It was just lit up. The world lit up around. It was amazing.
Yeah, and then you came to peace eventually.
Yeah. Yeah. 18 months later.
Yeah, and there's another whole story, right? Which probably we'd have to worry about at the moment. I remember David, he took a long time to think about all this. He took a very analytical approach. I remember one day him saying one day, would you say that God, the Holy Spirit, and he had this kind of detailed question, every typical David, in his long process of thinking through, how does this work? Anyway, he got there in the end, right? So anyway, friends, hunger for God makes the difference. And I'm going to read to you from this old letter Now, this is a letter that William Booth wrote in 1869 to a church in Edinburgh, in Scotland, because he was always urging people to break through spiritually, live holy lives, and win souls. And so we happen to have this old historic letter. Now, ignore the letterhead on the back, because I just happened to, in the old dot matrix days, run it off on old leftover Red Shield letterhead, back when I used to be the Red Shield director for Central Queensland. But in 1987 or six. But this was fully 120 years earlier. So let me read to you what he wrote. Now, this is slightly older English, which is a lot of fun. A lot of fun working out what these quaint expressions mean sometimes. So here's what he had to say. Success in soul winning, like all other work, both human and divine, depends on certain conditions. You must be careful to comply with these. I desire to give you a few brief practical hints. First and foremost, I commend one qualification which seems to involve all the others, and that is the Pentecostal baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now, when he says Pentecostal, he's not talking denominations, because it had not been invented yet. He's talking about the biblical experience, Acts 2 experience, the Pentecostal baptism of the Holy Ghost. He said, I would have you settle it in your souls forever, this one great immutable principle in the economy of grace, that spiritual work can only be done by those who possess spiritual power. Friends, spiritual work has to be done in your home. You know, the raising of your kids. Spiritual work has to be done in your workplace. Praying over your workplace. Praying for the sick. Sharing Christ. It doesn't matter where you live. Spiritual work has to be done. It can only be done by those who possess spiritual power. He writes on. Many mistake here. Aroused by the inward urgings of the Holy Spirit, they endeavor to comply with the call which comes from the Word of God and the necessity of their fellow men, but being destitute of this power, they fail. And instead of going to the strong for strength, they give up in despair. But then again aroused, again they resolve and venture forth, but having no more power than before, they're as impotent as ever. And fail they must until baptized with power from on high. This, I am convinced, is the one great need of the church. We want no new truths, new agencies, new means or appliances. We only want more of the fire of the Holy Ghost. This is what you, dear Edinburgh friends, need, the baptism of the Holy Ghost and of fire. I would not have you think that I imagine for a moment that you have not the Spirit. By your fruits I know you. No man could do the works that are being done in your midst except God was with them. But how much more might be done had you all received this Pentecostal baptism in all its fullness? Oh, what zeal, what self-denial, what meekness, boldness, holiness, love would there not be? And with all this, what power for your great work? The whole city would feel it. God's people in every direction would catch the fire, and sinners would fall on every side. Difficulties would vanish, infidels believe, and the glory of God be displayed. He writes on, you do desire to see the signs and wonders wrought in the name of Jesus, to see a great awakening among the careless crowds around you, to see hundreds, no thousands of feet turned into the way of life, would, I know, put gladness in your hearts, more than in the time when your corn and wine increase. He's using a biblical allusion there. So he ends with this. This baptism, then, is your first great need. Now, this paragraph, we just pause for a minute. This paragraph that he's about to write is as pertinent to you as anything I can say today. Listen carefully, but then I'm going to have to interpret something in it. He says, this baptism, then, is your first great need. If you think with me, that's an old expression for if you feel the same as me, will you not tarry for it? To tarry means to wait on God in prayer for it. So will you not tarry for it? Now here's where it gets interesting. Offer yourselves to God for the fullness. Lay aside every weight. Hold on. Though your feelings are barren, your way dark, and your difficulties be multiplied, steadily hang on to the word of God. Expect the baptism every hour, wait if he tarry. And then he quotes the scripture, this kind goeth not forth but by prayer and fasting. And he quotes another scripture, and the Lord whom you seek will come suddenly to his temple. Now, what I want to comment out of this last paragraph is this. He says, offer yourselves to God for the fullness, lay aside every weight, hold on, though your feelings are barren, your way dark, and your difficulties be multiplied, steadily hang on to the word of God. What is that all about? He names a number of things. He says, lay aside every weight. There's a biblical injunction to do so. What you'll find is there are things that hinder you. He says, lay aside every weight, though your feelings are barren. That's one of the first things you'll come across. You start to pray for the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you'll feel empty. You feel like nothing's happening. The feelings within you are not being stirred. It's hard to feel hungry. It just feels like there's nothing there. Your feelings are barren. Listen, that's common. This is normal. If that is the way you feel, that is normal. That's exactly where you begin. And you keep holding on, you keep pressing in. Listen to his advice. Though your feelings are barren, your way dark. That's the next thing. Very often, as you're praying in, it seems to get hard. It seems to get darker. The way just seems to be blocked. It seems like there's no light. No fresh word comes. That's exactly what happens. This is common spiritual experience. This is like what you've got to persevere through to get out the other side. And so, what's the next thing he mentions? And your difficulties be multiplied. Now, we used to identify a whole series of things that would hinder. You know, people would pray for the baptism of the Holy Spirit and not break through. What is it sometimes that hinders people? Carolyn's named one. Tony gave her the truth in day one, but she wouldn't receive it. You're too religious. And it turned out that weeks later, after weeks of, you know, prayer and waiting and soul searching and what's wrong with me, what was it? Very simple. Simple prayer to break a religious spirit off her life. And she's through. And this is the kind of thing. You don't know what hindrance you might have, what the very thing is that might be hindering you. Now, for some people, it's because they're just not hungry and the Lord's waiting. He wants to give you a lot, but he wants you to really find a hunger for God. But there are other things. Some people are carrying unforgiveness. I heard a story years ago of a fellow who for years prayed and prayed for the baptism of the Spirit, went to every meeting, had experts lay hands on him, couldn't break through, until one day in a meeting, a visiting speaker from America just suddenly got an insight and said to him, what's your relationship like with your mother? And he said, my mother, I hate her. He said, when I was a little boy, 5 years old, my mother left my father and me and my sister. She walked out and we've never seen her again to this day, and I've hated her all my life. Well, that was his problem. See, that's what you call a hindrance. It's a blockage in the way. This fellow was counseled in that point. He confessed his sin and repented, and he was instantly baptized in the Holy Spirit. So that was a blockage, a hindrance. And the Holy Spirit can reveal these. If there's a hindrance, he'll get light on that. The fellow I was praying with, way back when in 1974, when I was praying for the baptism of the Spirit, there was another guy. So we went to pray with two people who were already baptized in the Spirit. So there were two of us, big hunger, wanting more of God. On the very first night, 2 hours into prayer, this other guy gets a little vision from the Lord. Guess what the vision was? Dollar sign. This guy actually had money in the bank. He was a bit older, he'd had a bit more behind him, sold his business, had money in the bank. The issue was not having money. His problem was love of money. Right there in that meeting, I was present, he confessed his love of money, repented of it as a sin, was immediately baptized in the Holy Spirit. He didn't have to shift $1, but he had to change his heart, had to change his attitude. And this is the kind of thing. There can be hindrances. So You know, it can be any number of things. You know, there's no point working through a list of 20. I'm just giving you examples. You had one?
In Africa.
Where's the machine? Here it is.
In Africa, witchcraft is a big deal. If they've been playing around with Ouija boards, or if even in Australia, you've been playing around with Ouija boards or strange things, that can be a big hindrance as well.
Yeah. Any form of, you know, occultism. Basically, you're talking something that's of another spirit that's been given place in your life. No, you've got to clean that. Just renounce it. So there can be all kinds of things. We just read the phrase again. He says, offer yourselves to God for the fullness. Lay aside every weight. Hold on. Though your feelings are barren, your way dark, and your difficulties be multiplied, steadily hang on to the word of God. Expect the baptism every hour. Well, every hour is a biblical phrase for every minute, every moment. Expect it. And so this is the process. In prayer, you build expectant faith. You build hunger for God. Could I please say, the only biblical conditions for you to receive a baptism of the Holy Spirit is that you yield yourself to God and you ask. Ask. Do you remember the teaching where Jesus said, ask and you'll receive, seek and you'll find, knock and the door will be opened? He was trying to emphasize, he said it lots of ways, ask and keep on asking. That is applied to this as much as anything, because the very next thing he said was, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Asking is the major condition in Scripture. In other words, that you seek God. Remember, you will seek me and you'll find me when you search for me with all your heart. It's the major condition. But the things that go with it, of course, is your willingness to yield, your willingness to renounce sin, to forgive others. In other words, it's the way of Christ. You're choosing the way of Christ. And so then you begin to seek his face. Lay yourself out before the Lord. Every Christian life was meant to be empowered from above. Jesus said, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. He said, it's good for you if I go away. If I go away, I will send another Comforter to be with you forever, the advocate of the Father. He will take what is mine and reveal it to you. He will remind you of all the things I've said. He will guide you into all truth. And many other things like that Jesus had to say about the Holy Spirit. But eventually said, wait in Jerusalem for the gift my Father promised. This is the gift of the Spirit. He said, you will be endued with power from on high, not many days from now. In fact, it was 10 days later. They spent those 10 days in prayer and the Holy Spirit fell on them. I only spent 5 days in prayer. I got off light. Anyway, it's time, friends, take your hunger to another place and begin to seek after God. We're willing to pray for people today. Anybody, you know, desiring the fullness of the Spirit, we'll lay hands on you. And again, next week, the next week, we'll keep teaching a bit more about this. But in your prayers at home every day, just let your hunger grow. Keep reaching out to the Lord all the more. And next week, you know, hopefully if it goes this way, I'll teach you some of the practicalities with respect to what tongues is and isn't and some of those kinds of things. So anyway, we thank our panel. Did you have anything to add, dear brethren? No. So you would recommend you'd recommend, Tony, would you, being baptized in the Holy Spirit?
Yes, I would. It changes, just changes your whole life, really. Just completely turns it upside down. And I remember the 9 weeks or the 10 weeks after being baptized in the Holy Spirit, working in a job that was unsavory. Everything around me was unsavory, and the peace that God put on me, just like a whole other level of the Lord, the glory. It was amazing. It was amazing anyway, and remains amazing.
One of the fellows historically in the church that has taught the baptism of the Spirit extensively, wrote many books, was John Wesley. And John Wesley had a very extensive doctrine of the baptism of the Spirit. Now, this was a long time before what we know as the Pentecostal movement. And John Wesley described it with varying terms. But one of those terms was perfect love. Perfect love. And it, you could so experience the perfect love of God, and the love would transform your love so that you began to live out of a perfect love for other people and a more perfect motive toward other people in what you said and thought. This is what David testified to when he was just 5 years ago, had such an endowment of love from God. I would say one of the astounding things I received in 1974, I received a series of things, but you don't receive them as a series, it's just boom, and it so changes you, but you discover what they are as you go along. But the instant change I remember, aside from the evident power, I mean, what happened was the very next time I was in a meeting, which was, I mean, this happened to me at midnight. And then 9 o'clock the next morning, I'm in prayers with all the other cadets. And they say, you know, turn to song number 891, whatever it was. I turn it up. And the moment my eyes fell on the page, the words suddenly went, poof, they're about this big. What I'm seeing visually, huge words. And the meaning, just meaning, alive. But these were all side effects. The same when I opened the Bible later, just, oh, the meaning leaping off the page. But these were side effects. The thing I remember is that what took over my heart instantly was the sense of how loved I was by God. The love, that love seemed to take out of me every last root of insecurity. There never again was a need to have the assurance of another person that they loved me. The love itself was so complete that I was completely at peace, completely comfortable, no longer had any fear that someone didn't like me, that someone didn't hold me in high regard. It just didn't matter. The love of God so held me. And John Wesley called it perfect love. Friends, I am recommending it. Get hungry for God that you might have a baptism of the Spirit of another order altogether beyond present experience. Anyway, more about it. We've still got a couple of Sundays at least to open it up, you know, in different ways for your consideration, all the while hoping to make the church hungry. Why? Because the whole church can go to another level and we'd be more fruitful in service. You know, touching our families, touching the city, that kind of thing.